In this section, we're going to start with just some basics of the nuclear fuel cycle, basic definitions and basic structure. Nuclear fuel cycle itself is a system of installations, facilities, and activities that are interconnected by streams of nuclear material, where nuclear material would flow from one activity to another activity. There are a number of different types of nuclear fuel cycles in different states. There are very few states that have a fully developed nuclear fuel cycle. The most notable examples of that being Japan, France, and Russia, and India, that all have fully developed nuclear fuel cycles. But most states have a much simpler nuclear fuel cycle. In many cases, those states will only have one or two reactors, mainly power reactors, in which they'll import nuclear material into the country and then potentially export waste material out of the country. A few states also have just the front end portion of the nuclear fuel cycle, which we'll talk about later, where they'll actually produce their own nuclear fuel, but they won't have what we call the back end of the nuclear fuel cycle. The basic elements of a nuclear fuel cycle, we typically break into the mining and milling area, which is where you mine the raw material that you'll use as a fuel. The reactors, which are then used for either research, production of plutonium, usually for weapons purposes, or power reactors for the production of power. And then fuel cycle facilities themselves, which are typically facilities like conversion plants, which change uranium from one chemical form to another, enrichment plants, which will enrich uranium in the isotope U-235, fuel fabrication plants, which fabricate the fuel that's used in reactors, spent fuel reprocessing plants, which take the spent nuclear fuel out of the reactors and chemically process it in order to separate the material out and then be able to recycle that material for additional use in a reactor. And then, of course, storage facilities and waste treatment facilities for dealing with the waste products and materials that are stored during the fuel cycle activities. This is your basic generic commercial nuclear fuel cycle. There's a number of different pictures of this you'll see in the textbooks, etc. But the basic structure includes a front end, which deals with the material that is mined out of the earth that you'll then process in order to produce fuel for a nuclear reactor. The nuclear reactor area is sometimes referred to as the transmuter. That's just a fancy term for a nuclear reactor. Transmuter then transmutes that material. Radiologically, it changes some of the isotopes to other isotopes, and in doing that, releases energy that can then be used for peaceful purposes. And then the back end, which is the waste management section, as well as the fuel reprocessing section, where the spent nuclear fuel is reprocessed, and the plutonium then can be separated and removed and then reused. Your full-blown nuclear fuel cycle is a complete cycle in which material is taken out of the earth in a mining operation. In the milling operation, that material is then concentrated into a concentrated uranium product, what's called U-308 or yellow cake. That yellow cake then might be converted to another chemical form. The typical chemical form here would be UF6 or uranium hexafluoride. Uranium hexafluoride is then enriched in the isotope U-235. Natural uranium that you mine only contains 0.7% U-235. And for use in most power reactors, we want to have 3 to 5% U-235. So we'll enrich it in the isotope U-235 in order to make the relative fraction of that 3 to 5%. That'll then go into fabricating a fuel, which then goes into the reactor. That fuel can be stored in a storage facility that's at the reactor. Reactors may have separate fresh fuel storage from spent fuel storage. The fresh fuel storage is typically, the fresh fuel is much less radiological hazard. It has very little heat load to it, and so it can be stored in a much simpler way. Spent nuclear fuel typically has to be stored in water. It produces its own heat, and of course it's very radioactive. And so that material then would be stored in a water pool. Sometimes those two storage facilities are co-located. In some cases they're the same. The spent nuclear fuel itself then can go to a reprocessing plant where you then can separate plutonium and uranium out of the spent nuclear fuel and then recycle that. So that then goes back up to complete the cycle. Waste products that are produced from any of these operations then need to be dealt with in a high-level waste management system. This is just the simple example of a nuclear fuel cycle that we have here in the United States. As you can see, we do not have a complete fuel cycle in the U.S. We have a complete front end to our fuel cycle, and of course we have many reactors, about 104 operating power reactors in the United States, but our back end of the fuel cycle only includes high-level waste management capability. We do mine uranium in terms of ore. We then mill it to U-308 or yellowcake. We convert that to UF6. That then is enriched at any number of enrichment plants we have here in the United States. That's then fabricated into uranium dioxide pellets. Those pellets then get put together into fuel assemblies. Typically, those fuel assemblies include uranium dioxide pellets inside of a zircaloy can or zircaloy tube. Zircaloy is just an alloy of zirconium. That then goes to the reactor sites, and in the United States, all of our power reactors are light water reactors, so that means that they use typical light water, the water you would get in Mother Nature, to both cool and to moderate the reactor. And then the spent fuel that is produced in the United States currently is stored on-site at the reactors. So all of our 104 power reactors operating in the U.S. store their spent fuel locally on-site. In some cases, that spent nuclear fuel, after it's old enough and cool enough, can be removed and put into a dry cast storage. But in general, most of it is still stored in pools. At some point, that spent nuclear fuel then might go to a geological repository, which at present in the United States, we don't have an operating geological repository. The U.S. Department of Energy is required by law to produce a geological repository and to take all the spent nuclear fuel from the utilities and dispose of it. But they have not yet produced that repository. The law that required the U.S. Department of Energy to take that spent fuel also charged the utilities a fee per kilowatt hour per energy generated, and those utilities have been paying a fee to the U.S. government that money is what's used to produce Yucca Mountain. So Yucca Mountain is not funded by the U.S. government. It's actually funded by the utilities directly. That's stored into a fund that the U.S. government that then uses. And at some point, if that particular geological repository becomes available, all the spent nuclear fuel from the reactors will be moved there for permanent storage. These next two view graphs just show examples of military fuel cycles. So this is the Manhattan Engineering District during the Manhattan Project during World War II. And you may not be able to see all the details that's in this view graph. It's a very complicated view graph. But the picture itself still shows you the basic structure. So this picture and the next picture came out of a DOEEM document that just details some of the basic details of the Manhattan Project structure. But as you'll see, there's still a front end, which is mining and milling of uranium, fabrication of uranium targets, there's reactor irradiation, and then reprocessing at the Hanford Chemical Works, and there's an enrichment process here, and then, of course, weapons fabrication at Los Alamos. This basic structure is still very similar in some respects to a commercial nuclear fuel cycle. The facilities aren't the same, they're not operating the same way, but if you put the boxes together, you can still make a military fuel cycle look like a commercial nuclear fuel cycle from the standpoint of where the boxes go. This shows just the more complicated cycle that we had in the United States from the 1950s and 1960s, where we still had a front end portion to the fuel cycle, which was mining and milling, fuel fabrication and enrichment, reactor irradiation, but now we had another set of reactors. We had the Hanford reactors in Washington State, as well as the Savannah River reactors in South Carolina. Reprocessing operations at both Hanford and at Savannah River, and plutonium metal processing and fabrication at Rocky Flats and other areas. So that goes through the basic structure of the nuclear fuel cycles and the basic facilities that you would expect to see, facilities and elements you would expect to see in the fuel cycles themselves.